Welcome all of you to SST College of Arts and Commerce. This is SST Edupedia. Myself is Satish Kulkarni. I am a chemistry teacher for 11th and 12th 11th and 12th science. Today I am going to discuss about the first chapter of 11th science chemistry, that is some basic concepts in chemistry. So let's start with the topic. These are the important points which are to be covered in this chapter. Okay, so our chapter name is some basic concepts in chemistry. So let's first start with the introductory part, and that is, what is chemistry? Chemistry is the study of matter. As you know, matter is solid, liquid or gas. So in chemistry we study what are the physical and chemical changes or physical and chemical properties which are going to take place with solid, liquid and gas under different conditions, that is different temperature, different pressure and other conditions in which these matter is going to differ in their properties, that is studied under chemistry. Okay, it's a central science. The importance of chemistry is it is applicable to other branches of chemistry like physics, biological science, applied science, earth and space science. Earth science is like, you can say, geography, and space science, you know. So chemistry is this knowledge of chemistry is required in all these fields. Okay, another important thing about chemistry is it plays a very important role in our day-to-day life, like the food we eat. Okay, all the foods are nothing but chemicals. The fluids we drink, like water, clothing which we wear, and shelter where we live, the fuel which we use for our vehicles, all are chemicals. Okay, and it is not limited to this extent. It is limited, it can go beyond that. Okay, like chemistry is needed in our, you know, it is important components of our basic needs, like food, water, shelter and clothing. And not only that, safety is also a field in which chemistry plays an important role. Okay, why chemistry has become so important in nowadays? Because of technical development, technological advancement, we can go to the micro level analysis, and you know, the knowledge of chemistry clubbed with the knowledge of technology is going to be helpful to you in medicine, dentistry, engineering, agriculture, and in our day-to-day home products. Like, you know, in engineering chemistry has become the compulsory subject, that is applied chemistry. Same thing is in medicines also, and without knowledge of chemistry, agricultural study is impossible. Okay, now let's see, what are the branches of chemistry? Chemistry is a very vast subject. That's why it has to be categorized into different branches. The first branch of chemistry is organic, second is inorganic, then it comes physical, and then comes analytical. Let's see what are they one by one. Organic chemistry is a study of properties and reactions of carbon. Without carbon there is no organic chemistry. Okay, whatever is not covered in organic comes under inorganic, like acids, bases, metals, non-metals. Okay, physical chemistry, it is a branch of chemistry which is very much related to physics. Here we study different laws, you know, we study the properties of matter, again solid, liquid and gas. Okay, here principles are studied, laws are studied. Analytically is the branch which is related to the experimental aspects of chemistry. Here we analyze different substances. The analysis includes separation of the chemicals, their identification and quantification. Okay, and since quantification is done in analytical chemistry, it is very much applicable in pharmaceutical industry, where quantity plays an important role. Okay, further, let's see what is, as we know, we already said chemistry is the study of matter. We should know what is matter. Matter is the one which occupies space and mass. It can be classified into two parts, pure substances and mixture on the basis of chemical composition. Let's see its classification in the flow chart. The main two components of matter are pure substances and mixture. Pure substances further classified into elements and compounds. Elements are further classified into metals, non-metals and metalloids. Okay. Mixtures are further classified into homogeneous mixture and heterogeneous mixture. Now we'll see them one by one. Pure substances, what do you mean by pure substances? The one which has definite chemical composition. All right. Their properties are similar. They have similar properties regardless of their origin. For example, water can be obtained from rain. Water can be prepared in laboratory. But the chemical composition of water is not going to change. It is H2O. Hydrogen has to be two atoms and oxygen has to be one atom. So irrespective of its origin, the properties are going to remain same. This is one example. Mixture, on the contrary, has no definite chemical composition. It can vary from place to place. For example, you know, examples of pure substances are like pure metal, distilled water. As I said, water is not going to change its property. But if you see the examples of mixture, paint prepared at one place is totally different from the paint prepared at another place. It can be different. The quantity of oil, pigment and additives, which are the components of paint, they may not be same. Okay, concrete, which we use for construction, it is a mixture of sand, cement and water. It is not going to be fixed. It is going to change. So this is called as mixture, where pure substances, their composition is fixed. Okay, now let's see further about pure substances. It is further divided into elements and compounds. What do you mean by elements? The elements are one which cannot be broken down into simpler substances by ordinary chemical reaction, which cannot be divided further. Examples are metals, non-metals and metalloids. Okay. So let's see first what are metals. What properties should metals should possess? They should have luster. That means they should be shining. Okay. The surface of the metals are generally shining in nature. They have shiny appearance. They should, you know, they conduct heat and electricity. They are good conductors of heat and electricity. It can be drawn into wires. Okay. This property is called as ductility, which can be drawn into wire, like aluminium wires, iron wires, and so on. They can be hammered into thin sheets. We can make the sheets of metal, like aluminium sheet, iron sheet, and so on. This property is called as malleability. Okay. Examples are gold, silver, copper, iron, aluminium, zinc, you name them. Okay. These are some pictures of them. Gold, silver, copper. Okay. So if these properties are there, then you can call them as metals. There is an exception for it. Mercury, you cannot make the wires of mercury, okay? You cannot make the sheets of mercury, but still mercury is a metal. You know, it is liquid at room temperature. Other metals are like gold, silver, copper and iron, aluminium are solid. Mercury is an exception. It is liquid metal at room temperature, okay? You know, this is how mercury appears. Non-metals. Now, what do you mean by non-metals? They do not have luster. Metals possess luster, but non-metals are having no luster. Exceptions are there, of course, diamond and iodine. They are poor. Metals are good conductors of heat and electricity. Non-metals are poor conductor. There is an exception: graphite. You cannot hammer non-metals into sheets, or you cannot draw them into wire, because they are brittle. They can be broken easily. Okay. So, examples of non-metals are iodine, nitrogen and carbon. Metals, non-metals are solids and gases. Okay, there is one exception. So, iodine is solid, nitrogen is gas, carbon is solid. They appear like this. This is how iodine appears. This is nitrogen gas. Okay, but there is an exception for non-metal which is not solid or liquid, and that is bromine. Bromine is a non-metal at room temperature, but it is liquid at room temperature. This is how bromine appears. Okay, then the one which is neither metallic nor pure metal, not pure non-metal, are metalloids. Okay, so metalloids are the one which are having properties intermediate between metals and non-metals. They are called as metalloids, or they are also called as semi-metals. The examples are arsenic, silicon and germanium. This is how they appear. Arsenic, it's a poisonous substance, it's a poisonous non-metal, it's a poisonous chemical, you can say arsenic. Silicon, you know, the computer chips are made up of silicon. Germanium is also useful. Okay, so these are the examples of metalloids. Now, what are compounds which are different from elements? What do you mean by elements which cannot be broken further? But compounds are, can be broken down into simpler substances by ordinary chemical changes. Okay, what are compounds? The one which are made up of at least two or more than two, say two or three elements combined together in fixed proportion. Example, carbon dioxide. Carbon is an element, oxygen is an element, but carbon dioxide is not an element, it's a compound. And the composition of carbon and oxygen in carbon dioxide has to be fixed, 1 and 2. Like water, it is also a compound, hydrogen 2, oxygen 1, like that. So compound is the one in which two or more than two metals are combined in fixed proportion. Okay, now what do you mean by mixture? Mixtures are the one which contain two or more substances in no fixed proportion, and they can be separated by physical methods. For example, and further, they can be divided into homogeneous and heterogeneous mixture. What do you mean by homogeneous mixture? You know, what are the examples of homogeneous mixture? Solutions. You can call solutions as homogeneous mixture because the molecules of constituent solute and solvent, because you know solution is made up of solute and solvent, they are the constituents of solution, are uniformly mixed through its bulk. That means they have got single layer. Let me give an example. The solution of salt in water, okay, and solution of sugar in water. Now why do we call solution of salt in water as homogeneous mixture? Because it forms one layer. And why it is called mixture? Because if you evaporate water, you will get the salt back. It can be separated. Same is the case with sugar in water. If you evaporate water, you will get the sugar back, and you can again make the solution of sugar in water. So they are separable. Okay, so that's why it is called a mixture, and since it forms a uniform layer, it is homogeneous mixture. On the other hand, the other one is, that is heterogeneous mixture, is the one which are not uniformly mixed throughout the bulk. Example is suspension of an insoluble solid in liquid, that is sand in water. You know, it cannot be, it doesn't form a uniform layer, it always forms two layers. And another is also oil and water, is also a, you can call it as heterogeneous mixture. Okay, here you will find always two different layers. One layer is oil and another is water. One layer is sand layer and another is water. Okay, so far we have seen today what is chemistry is all about. Okay, what is the importance of chemistry, then what are the branches of chemistry, okay, organic, inorganic, physical and analytical, and what do you mean by them. Then we have studied the matter, what are the what matter is all about, its classification, like pure substances and mixture. Pure substances be classified as elements and compounds. Elements be further classified as metal, non-metal and metalloid, their properties, their examples. Then mixture, homogeneous and heterogeneous, their properties and their examples. So this is introductory part of our first chapter, that is some basic concepts in chemistry. Thank you very much.